Wild horses have roamed the Nevada landscape for more than a century. Nearly half of all the wild horses in the United States can be found in the Silver State. Traveling in herds and small bands, their diversity of colors highlight the sometimes barren-looking deserts and mountains. With over 250,000 acres of public land in Nevada, it becomes necessary to maintain a balance between the wildlife, forage, and domestic livestock. The responsibility for this lies with the Bureau of Land Management.
We're gathering these horses under an emergency due to the lack of winter snow and spring moisture. The winter snow, of course, recharges the springs and fills the water holes. That didn't happen, so the horses are running out of water. Also, that same spring moisture provides a growth medium for the plants. And there's very little forage growing out here for the wild horses. We also have 171 antelope out here that are dependent on this forage for their survival. There's 700 head of horses out here. We're going to gather 600 head of them. What the helicopter does is goes out into the hills here and brings the horses in. He'll bring them in a few at a time and then bring them down this big valley down here and run them into the wings of the track. As soon as we get them into the trap corrals, then we load them up onto small stock trailers and we ship them to our holding facility, our central holding facility out here. Right here at this corral, this is where we bring the horses in. Once they're gathered, we bring them in here. Here they're sorted off by age, by sex, and then they're fed and watered. We're also putting some electrolyte in the water because of the dehydration problem, and it helps the horses along a little bit before we ship them over to Palomino Valley. And then they'll be adopted out or put in long-term holding.
Many people see the romance of owning a Mustang, which was once wild. However, the horses are still wild. They require a great deal of training before they are gentle enough to be ridden, and often individuals don't have the time or expertise to accomplish this. For many, this becomes a barrier to adopting a horse. However, a very unique program is proving to be an answer for some.
Hi, my name is Tim Bryan. I'm the manager of the Nevada State Prison Farm. As part of our program, we also have a horse training program over at Warm Springs Correctional Center here in Carson City. The program started in the year 2000, and we train a combination of BLM and state astray horses. When the horses arrive from Palomino Valley, which is a collection site for the BLM north of Reno, we sort them off, and we actually have a facility out here that we can hold up to 800 horses. We'll break them up into mare or gelding groups. And typically while they're here, depending on how long they're here, we'll booster them with vaccines. We'll trim their feet up. We'll care for them and feed them every day for the BLM. These horses are, when they come to us, they've been in captivity, some for a very short time, short as maybe 6 weeks and as long as a year or two. We try not to train any horses that are over 5 years old, and that's just because through experience, we've noticed that horses that are older than that, they're very hard to break, very temperamental. They've been, because we mainly do geldings out here, and they've been running with groups out there and their leaders, and they're very hard to break from time to time.
On a snowy February morning, 12 wild horses are experiencing their second day of training. Under the guidance of an experienced trainer, inmates will spend the next 3 months gentling these horses. Both the inmates and horses are beginning a new relationship.
We have inmates that are their minimum custody here at this prison, And they have to have actually a good track record while they're in prison. They shouldn't have any write-ups or anything in the last 6 months. It's kind of a reward as well as a learning experience for these guys.
When I first came out here, I didn't know how to ride a horse. I've never even seen a horse before. So now I've been out here 2 years and I break horses, or gentle horses, I guess we could say.
With the new techniques that they're using nowadays, these are called round corrals, and you actually chase the horse around the pen and get him moving either direction. You try to control which way he's moving. So you actually start controlling the horse right from the start, even before you even touch him. What you do is actually assert a prey animal stance to get the horse moving. You'll kind of squat down, stare at the horse. The horses are very observant of your stare. What they're really afraid of is they're going to be eaten because they don't know what the human is. They actually think he is a prey animal. As you can see, all the prey animals, the cats, the wolves, and the human, all their eyes are mounted on the front of their head. Horses, cattle, whatnot are mounted on the side, so they're grazing animals. And so with our eyes on the front of our head, we're actually coming across to the horse as a prey animal. And by lowering your head and lowering your eyes, you take that stance away, and the horse learns to relax. And then you start rewarding him. Every time that he looks at you and quits moving, you'll actually quit pursuing him. And through repetition, he'll learn that you're not out to hurt him, hopefully.
Yesterday I only worked him for about an hour and a half, but today is my second day on him, and he's going to be a little trouble. He's real flighty, real scary. I'm trying to get him used to me so I can pet him, and if I can pet him, I think that he'll come around. Once I get that, though, I think I'll be all right.
The horses are they're very candid. They'll actually tell you when they're accepting what you're doing with them. They'll lick. That's actually lick their lips and mouth. These are things that foals do to show that they're not aggressive or a prey animal. And the horses will do that at the time that they're accepting your training. And that's your first step, and that's what you work towards.
After several weeks of working with the horses, which can be challenging and sometimes even dangerous, the intense training is beginning to pay off. It takes long hours and lots of patience on the part of both the trainers and the horses, but trusting relationships are beginning to evolve between the two.
I've been working for about 3 weeks now. He's real scared. Real scared. It's taken me a lot to try to calm him down. He's coming pretty slow. I think he'll come around eventually pretty quick, but he's just a handful right now. He just fights me with everything, it seems like. And then I get angry and then he gets more scared. So it's teaching me a lot to try to keep calm, because it's not his fault. He's just trying to survive, you know what I mean? And yeah, he's just real flighty. He's real scared. He likes to run away and run off. So that's my goals right now, just to fix all that so anybody can come in here and ride him or saddle him or do whatever with him.
Well, he's getting ready to trim his feet. But this horse has only been here about 3 weeks in the program. So he's a little suspicious about his feet. The horse has to really trust you to give you his feet. He loves me.
Yeah.
Let me have him. Let me have him. I'm not going to jerk on him. Whoa. Whoa. What's the matter with you? Be gentle. Be gentle. Be gentle. Mm-hmm. Come here. Whoa, where are you going? Where are you going? Whoa. You're petting too slow. He's real tight in the flank. Okay, I'm just gonna squeeze him here until he softens up, relaxes, then I'm gonna pet him. Real tight, I'm gonna tighten him up. Soften up. You wouldn't kick a guy, would you? Whoa. You wouldn't kick a guy, would you? Whoa. 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 You wouldn't kick a guy, would you? Would you kick a guy? You think you got him ready, Jimmy? Huh? Okay, that's what I'm telling you. The horse is not ready. And you're asking a guy to crawl underneath him and get hurt. You know, what you're gonna have to do is you're gonna have to push this horse to a kind of a panic level and then calm him back down and push him up and calm him down. So you got some more work to do. Lots of gentlemen.
I've been in this program since the end of September. I've done this, I grew up on a ranch, done this most of my life. Not to say that I haven't learned quite a bit since I've been in this program from Hank. New methods work out pretty well. Stuff that I never dreamed of doing at home, I've done here, and you can be assured I'll take this home and do it there. This colt is only, we started him a couple of weeks ago. He's only got about 5 rides on him. He's coming around pretty good. He's kind of a handful, but once he's learning to trust and gentle a little bit, he's giving in, so he's gonna make a pretty good horse. He's a little bossy. You gotta earn his respect before you're gonna get anything with him, and if he doesn't give you the respect, you're not gonna get anywhere to fight with him. So it's kind of a give and take with this colt. He's, you gotta earn every bit of it.
I'm conditioning the horse for a shoulder rear end movement for a transfer into the saddle for leg positions. When the horses understand where you position your legs, they don't fear, and they start to understand that these pressures are what help them move when we're riding them. This horse has been a little leery from day one, so I've had to do a bunch of gentling on him for him to start understanding that there's not going to be any easy, as you can see. Understand that he gets a little more love than... Come on. There you go. All right. Are you doing all right? Are you scared? Are you scared? Let me make a movement here. Good. From day one, we teach him the little pressure here, nothing to harm them. They can get used to our feet touching their sides and directing that movement. And I'm a stickler about the lateral movement that these horses get. You take them from a level that's higher than they'll normally reach when their new owners are with them. When we sack them out, we go a little bit further. We'll use a plastic bag on them. We'll wave. We'll use our ropes, our lead ropes, and condition them for for this as a danger, factor. When they give us the response, we'll give them a relief, give them a little love, and get a lick out of them.
Almost 3 months have passed, and the horses are nearly ready for their new owners. The transformation is amazing.
These horses were started approximately 90 days ago. This is kind of the final leg of their training period. They'll be up for auction in a couple of weeks here at Warm Springs.
Last time you were here, I couldn't barely ride him. I couldn't barely touch him, and now he's pretty darn broke now. He's rides real nice. He's pretty gentle. He's still a little scary, a little flighty, but for the most part, he's doing well in his training. He got a real nice mover, nice stop. Real athletic horse. He's doing good. He's gonna be my best horse I made probably. And I've been out here 2 years, so I've made a lot of horses, and he'll probably be the best one though. He's my favorite one so far, so.
We're just saddle breaking him, halter breaking him, trying to make him as soft and as gentle as we can, because usually they buy him for like little kids. And well, my main thing right now with him is just trying to get him to lope on a smooth lope where, you know, some little kid won't fall off. It's like he's an albino horse. According to what Hank says, you could tell he's albino because his skin is pink. His skin is pink, he's got blue eyes. He's 13 hands. And right now, he's to a point where he uses a hackamore, and it's not a bit no more in his mouth because he responds real well to that. He's a very smart little horse.
This is my first horse, so I've been having a lot of help from one of the senior trainers, Ron Abbott, and I just come in the morning, make sure he's listening to me, being respectful, facing me up, coming to me, you know, doing everything I ask. If I ask him to move to the side, that he'll do it, and then come back and face me so he's listening. Over here. Come on. And then when he's listening on the ground, he's more apt to listen to you when you're on his back. He moves just his front shoulders, his hind corners. I get him to side pass from side to side. He trailer loads. He's got a real good stop on him. Just listens, and he's real athletic. So he moves real well.
Well, this is my first horse. Right now I'm in the training period, learn how to ride better, and learn little bits here and there from the other inmates, senior trainers, and from Hank, our supervisor, and pretty much this horse has taught me as much as I've tried to teach him. Calmed him down a lot. He's already known his cues and his commands and his job, but he was kind of reluctant at first, and now he's pretty gentle, and he knows all the stuff. He does his job well.
Picks up his leads nice when he's loping. Got about four different speeds. He'll speed up at a trot. Good little stop on him. I've been stepped on a couple times, but I've been the lucky one. I haven't been bucked off yet in a year. Easy, easy little loper. They do tight little circles. Great, he's great. He can do anything. He's ready to please. I can do almost anything with him.
Last winter, the 4-H club here locally came to us and wanted us to possibly train some Mustangs for the 4-H kids. and with a compact that they made with BLM and us, we've brought three of these horses in to train them for the kids. This is Dan Norman. He's one of my senior trainers, and this horse's name is Romeo. One of the girls named him. She picked him out herself and brought him in, and Dan spent a lot of time with him. All the guys, Brian Peacock and Dean Kruk also have trained one, and they've done a real good job with them. They spent a lot of extra time getting these horses extra gentle because they're gonna be for kids. This is Monday morning. These horses have had 2 days off. He's basically about a 100-day colt. He's had about probably 80 to 90 rides in those 100 days. They spend countless hours making sure they're gentle. All in all, they're a bunch of really nice horses, and we're pretty proud of them. I think the guys have done a great job. You consider the fact that about 90% of these guys have no previous experience at all. I think it's a remarkable thing in itself.
Many of the inmates have become attached to their horses, and with the end in sight, there are mixed emotions.
It has two effects on me. I'm uplifted when they do leave, knowing that I put a lot of effort into them. And it's a little saddened that I was with them for so long.
It's really opened my eyes. This is the best thing I ever had going in my life. Heck of a place for it to happen. So make a person grow up.
Personally, I'm satisfied. If I know the colt's good and he's going to a good home, it's not that big of a deal. It's more satisfying than mourning, you know what I mean?
It's pretty exciting. It's a fun experience to live in life, to when you get a horse that comes from the wild mountains and you can't touch them, and the next thing you know, they're following you, they let you ride them, and they become your friends. You know, I mean, sometimes you get close to them when they get sold or adopted, you know, you kind of choke a little bit. Well, I do.
When you're in prison, you know, you got different politics and rules, and you know, you're taught not to show your emotion or any pride in what you do. And since I've been out here, you know, it's just given me a new life and a new hope. And you know, I finally get to show emotion and passion for something that I do.
I'll miss him, but you know, I talked to Hank already about that, and he seems to believe, and Ron believes in me, and each horse I get is going to be better and better, so, you know, I'll miss him being my first horse. It'll be sad. You know, spend 3 months with him every day, and then all of a sudden he's gone. Yeah, I'll be a little sad.
The former warden here, Robin Bates, when he first told me about the job, said it was a win-win situation. He said that everybody wins, the BLM, the Nevada Department of Agriculture, the prison system, and the horses. These guys are getting the horses accustomed to noise. We got music on in here. We don't want it to be a big surprise at the auction when the loudspeaker comes on. We start auctioning off the horses, and that way the horses are more confident, and they look better for the public. And well, they actually are better because they're used to different noises. These guys are basically just preparing for the auction, which is 2 weeks away.
We typically at our auctions, we have a live auctioneer. We have an auctioneer that understands horses. He knows how to train horses, and that's a big asset to us, because lots of times it's not uncommon to stop the auction and take the saddle off and let the inmate, if he can, ride it bareback. They pick their feet up. I've seen them stand on their backs and jump off their backs.
Adoption Day. This is the culmination of months of work, where horse and trainer come together to show the prospective owners what they have accomplished. Visitors can get a close-up view of the horses and chat with the trainers about each horse's uniqueness and personality.
This is always special for us because these animals have been through quite a bit of training over the last 90 to 100 days, and we see very high success in the folks that come out and adopt these horses over the next year. And then, of course, about a year from now, if everything goes well, they'll have title to these animals.
We represent the state Astray Horses. We are a 501c3 nonprofit group, and what we do are rescues up in the Virginia range. Considering VRPA was the first one that worked with Paul Iverson and got the first pens here, we think it's phenomenal. This is what we were striving for, is to have these wonderful sales and another way to find good homes for these animals.
A large crowd waits in anticipation for the auction to begin.
We're looking at some of these BLM horses from the, I guess they call them the Jackson Mountains. They'll probably make pretty good stout rope horses. Some of these little horses have a lot of spirit to them, but they can't quite hold a cow when you need a doctor or something like that.
Well, thank you very much for attending our auction. We have 12 horses that have been in training for about 90 days, and it's a combination of BLM horses and state Astray horses.
These guys have worked real hard on these horses. They've been here approximately 90 to 120 days, most of them, and they've done a real good job with them. Some of these horses have been riding a lot longer than the cowboys. Hey, this is the first horse we're going to auction. This is Lucky. He's a 5-year-old. And as you can see, he's a nice, big, stout colt.
Side passing.
He's ready to go to work.
Look at the eye on that horse. Look at the conformation of that head. You couldn't find any better horse than that. Look at there.
$1,000. $1,000. Now let's
have him
get well. Now let's
have him
get his horse.
Look at our bareback. 70. Look at the 1800. 1800.
3.
We have one Mustang we've owned for over a year now. I needed a horse, so I have kind of been looking at these guys and a little apprehensive just because I wasn't quite sure if I wanted a green horse because I'm a green rider. But the trainer that worked with Dreamcatcher said he's just real kind, loves people, so bought Dreamcatcher today.
This is a good colt here.
You want to hire out your horse, make a little extra income? You know, you can hang around all those joints and stuff. Remote control! Cruise control! Where you get that power brakes?
We got a bargain today. We've got a 6-year-old bay gelding that's been here for over 2 years, they said, and trained a lot of people, so hopefully it's one I can stay on.
we have 6 Mustang horses. And I bought this one here, the cream line for my granddaughter, the little bay for my wife. I can't find no fault in them, no fault at all. I know some cowboys that couldn't do a job these guys had done.
But there's a number of horse trailers here, so I think most of these horses will find good homes today and be on a whole new spread by the end of the day.
We've seen inmates just mature unbelievably, make great strides in becoming better people, more tolerant with other inmates over there. And hopefully they'll take those human skills, as we call them, to the outside and be a productive citizen.
The long journey of the wild horse is coming to an end as he begins a new life with his proud new owner.
Well, our first night home, of course, if you see how our setup is, there's an inside area and an outside. He wasn't coming in. But if you think of it in a horse's mind, that's a cave. You don't go in a cave, that's a scary thing. So I fed him outside, not wanting to punish him, you know, let him feed and let him get used to it. By 9 o'clock that night, we had him inside eating. When we pulled him out of the trailer that in the front pasture, you should have seen his eyes. I swear they doubled in size because he just saw all that grass. The training at the prison is incredible. They're side passing. I mean, they're doing things that a lot of horses can't do. The important thing when you get one there, though, is staying on top of the training, because they're young horses. So you want to stay on top of the training, repeat what they've done there. So that's why I said we do a lot of groundwork. We've done a lot of groundwork, and he's been under saddle 3 times now in the last 3 weeks, and he's perfect. He's a perfect gentleman. The other day when we were bringing the horses in, my husband called him. He wouldn't come to him, but I called him and he came to me. I was so excited. I said, look at that, he came to me. What a good boy. Good boy, that's a first. Good boy. Good boy. Yes, doing a lot of bonding, a lot of groundwork, and just enjoying each other, huh?